Well, good morning, Catalina Foothills Church. My name is John Stone. I want to welcome you to worship with us. It's a privilege and honor that you would join us here for our worship service. And on behalf of the session, the deacons, and our staff, thanks so much for honoring us with your presence. I especially want to welcome you if you're a new member or recently new, and I want you to know that we've become a normal church. We have a gift for you, and it's not a Bible or a tract. You actually get a coffee mug with our name on it, and a notepad, and a map of the church, and information about the church. So if you're new, those will be in the back. We'd invite you to grab one. I want to say, I'm going to do something a little bit unusual as we start today, because most of you know, if you're new, you don't know this, that I begin, and I'm going to begin this service the same way, by inviting you into three things: into resting and reminding and reflecting. And what we say every week is that Jesus has promised us to give us rest. And in that rest in Christ, we also gather to remind each other that we are loved by God and He calls us to love us. And we hope that as we remind each other of that, as we rest in that, we will reflect that here to our neighbors and to Tucson and to Arizona and to the ends of the earth. That's our hope. But I think in light of a particularly unusual week for us as a country, I'm gonna actually read a part of Psalm 95. Now, Psalm 95 is what we're going to look at today in our sermon, that part of our worship when we do teaching. And that what Psalm 95 is an invitation to worship, and we're going to talk about worship today. But it was an interesting week. I'll tell you in a funny way, I'll mention this in the sermon, I missed Wednesday. I locked myself in my office, did a bunch of study, I had to go play in a charity golf tournament, and when I got home at 6 o'clock, I had all these text messages, and somebody's like, have you seen what's happened? And no, and so I missed the whole thing. But something interesting happened there. I don't know how profound it was. I had some friends tell me it's the most important thing in American history. I'm not sure. But I do think it's interesting for Christians. So before we do a call to worship, I'd just like you to hear Psalm 95 and us reflect on it as we begin to worship. He says, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before Him with thanksgiving and extol Him with music and song. Now listen to this. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. As Christians, we come today to worship the King above all kings. There can be a dispute in any country, including our own, about who should be in power. Those will not only happen now, but they will continue. But there'll never be a dispute in the mind of the Christian that God is the great King, the great President, the great Chancellor above all. And we can come with that confidence. But he also says, in his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. His hands formed the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. And before I read the last sentence, I think there's some discussion, kind of interesting in this country, about who we belong to. This is what Scripture says about us. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the sheep under his care, the flock under his care. No matter what happens in our world, in our culture, God is our God. We are his people, and he is for us. And that can never change. No matter what happens on any particular Wednesday or the next election or the next fall, no matter what happens in the coronavirus, we are his people. And in that light, we come to worship. So would you stand with me for our call to worship this morning? I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever.
With my mouth, I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations.
I declare that your steadfast love is established forever.
Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens.
Come, let us worship the Lord our God together. Would you pray with me? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we rejoice, we magnify, we glorify you because you are the great God, the great King above all gods. And in your hands are the depths of the earth, and these mountains behind me, they belong to you. You made the sea, you made the Atlantic, you made the Indian Ocean, you made it all. And you also formed the land. So let us come and worship. Let us bow down because you're our Maker. Lord, we were made to worship you. So now receive our singing, hear our prayers. As we come full of faith, encourage our faith. If we come with doubts and questions, answer them. Lord Jesus, meet us. We need you. We need worship. And so we offer ourselves to you, and we do this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Faithfulness, oh God, you wrestle with the sinner's restless hearts.
Oh, I can hear you this morning.
You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart.
Amen.
So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God.
Here we go.
Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me.
Great is your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along.
So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me.
Sing it again.
Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. So remember your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough,
hallelujah.
Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough. Heaven reaches out to us. Your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough. I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me.
Man, I felt that one. I feel it today. All right, let's sing Our God.
Of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you.
Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you, our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God, our God.
Let's sing it again.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
one more time.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
And please remain standing for a confession of faith.
Well, amen. You may be seated. Oh. All right. Good to be here with you this morning. And are we on?
John, we turned that off.
We did.
Which is bottom line.
Is that
right,
bud?
Are we here? Are we there? Yeah. Okay. Okay, here we come. We come to a confession of sin. And many of you may be familiar with James 3, chapter 2, which says that most of us stumble with and have some problems. Actually, it doesn't say that at all. It says we all stumble in many ways. Even the godliest person in the room, the Bible says we all stumble in many ways. And that's why we come to a confession of sin this morning. So, Christian, what is your confession of sin? Oh, God, you have shown us the way of life through your Son, Jesus Christ. We confess with shame our slowness to learn from him, our failure to follow him, and our reluctance to bear the cross. Have mercy on us, Lord, and forgive us. We confess the poverty of our worship, our neglect of fellowship and of the means of grace, our hesitation to witness for Christ, and our imperfect stewardship of your gifts. Have mercy on us, Lord, and forgive us. Amen. And let's take a moment of silent confession now. Amen. So Christians, lift up your heads. Hear the words from God's word about the compassion and forgiveness that we have in our brother Jesus. Scripture says, "Come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. And though they are red like crimson, they shall be like wool." Isaiah 1:18. Therefore, Christians, you are forgiven because of the work of Christ. The Lord loves to forgive his people, so let us rise and sing his praises.
Amen. I can really hear and feel the worship in here today, so let's continue by singing "In Christ Alone."
Whoa, 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 whoa.
my strength. I find my home. I find my help in Christ alone. When fear assails, when darkness falls, I find my peace in Christ alone. I give my life, I give my all. I sing this song to Christ alone. The King of Kings, the Lord of all heaven sings to Christ alone.
Now time for a fun one.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
My God. Upon wings like eagles.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
dust up on the wheels I keep.
One more time.
You are the everlasting God. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. The strength arises.
You do not fade. You
wait upon the Lord.
Remain standing for a confession of faith.
Amen. Thank you. One of my buddies called me this week, and he was at a Bible study. He's like, Turner, is this what we believe? Is this what we believe? He'd been to a Bible study. He wasn't really sure. You know, and upon him calling, I thought to myself, you know what? That's why. That's why we do a confession of faith every week, right? To remind ourselves, this is actually what we believe. This is what we're leaning on. This is what we are relying on Monday through Saturday. And you know this, whether it be the TV, whether it be the home, whether it be the job site, you know, your iPhone, if you're an unfortunate person, you're constantly being given messages, a lot of ink being spilled, trying to convince you this is truth, this is truth. And we pause each week to do this thing called a confession of faith to remind us this is truth. This is what we believe, right? So with that, will you join me in remembering just what we believe, what we're leaning on? From Romans 8. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship, persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For we are convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
We're going to enter in now to the prayers of the people. And one thing we want to hopefully do is help you think about the way you should pray when you're at home or driving around in your car or in the morning when you pray or evening or when you walk. So in these prayers, I'm going to lead us, and you're going to respond with, Lord, have mercy. And then we're going to have a time of silence. And what's intended to happen in that time of silence is one person will stop praying, and everybody will pray along the lines that we've spoken. So let's bow our heads in prayer. For our pastors, and for all the clergy and Christians in Tucson, and for the persecuted church, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Spirit to come down and for us to see revival, first in the church and then in our culture and in our country, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our current and future president, for the leaders of the nations, our leaders in Tucson and Arizona, and for all in authority over us, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the good earth which God has given to us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, care for it, and love it, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the aged and infirmed, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord. For deliverance from the coronavirus, for deliverance from anger and hatred among our citizens, and for deliverance from those who suffer from injustice and powerlessness from their enemies, let us pray to the Lord. for the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captive, and for all who remember and care for them. Let us pray to the Lord. That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach, free of fear and full of faith in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, we offer all of our prayers to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. It is good to be with you again. Let me start our time before we look at God's Word with some announcements. The first one is, beginning in the morning, we're going to have a new website. So I think a slide will be coming up. Will it? Here we go. So this is just a corner of it because we know the things that you tend to go to the website for are events, how to watch, how to give, and those are prominent there. We're just redoing it. Now, you'll see a login there. If you don't know what that means, that's fine. You don't need to log into the website to use it. Any of those buttons you click about, Sundays, Ministries, Event, works without logging in. We actually have some church software that we're using, and eventually you'll learn how to log in. It lets you change the way you give. Only you can see it when you log in. It also shows you activities you can do. So just know that that'll be up there tomorrow. And let me say, because it's new, it's not going to work sometimes. So bear with us, but we're going to try. The second announcement I have is our mercy team is searching for your talents, and that's called the MyFit Talent Bank. And as you leave today, there'll be those serving on the serve team, the deacons, and they'd love you to sign up for what you might do to help someone in our congregation. Are you an electrician? Can you sit for someone? Can you pick up medicine for someone who's homebound? Can you call a shut-in? Can you fix plumbing? Can you pick something up that's heavy for someone who's older? There's a myriad of ways to serve, and we would love for you to sign up so that our deacons are not overwhelmed, especially during a pandemic. We've had a lot of requests for very simple help, and those who can offer simple help are very helpful to us. So please, on your way out, sign up for that. Our marriage conference is coming up on, and I wish the date was here. Oh, there it is, January 22nd and 23rd. And we're going to have that here in the sanctuary. That's a Friday evening from, didn't we say 6 to 9, right? And then 8:30 to 11:30 the next morning. And need you to sign up, especially if you need childcare. Now, if you feel like those of you who are streaming at home, you can't come, we're going to stream that. But let me pause now for a moment and say, it's better when trying to watch something currently streaming at CFC. And we're working on getting fiber optics put in. That you wait for us to upload it and watch it in one go. It just is true, because when everybody logs on, we can usually get it out, but for instance, in the foothills, we have terrible internet. And so often, we'll receive text message and very good saying, hey, it's not working. Sometimes that's on your end, sometimes that's on our end. We're working to solve our end's problems. But like, you might want to let this upload and then go watch it at one setting. And so those will be up there, but you can watch it live streamed and then you can watch it recorded. We're also going to do four evenings, Sunday evenings following this weekend, not that weekend, but the ones where we're going to do a dinner, childcare, and a discussion and a little teaching time on Sunday evening here, 5:30 to 7, to help you work through all the things John Cox said. We're real excited about that. We need you to register online. We need to know how many are coming, especially if you need childcare. And finally, our women tomorrow night's ladies games and gab bunco is tomorrow night, Monday at 6:30 in the youth room, just to my left and to your right. And I don't agree with this announcement. It takes zero skill, so we're going to teach you to do it. If I need to teach you to do it, it requires skill. I just want to point that out. But let me say, I don't think it requires much. So if you've never been, you'd like to get to know more of the women in this church, you can show up for that. It's a blast. That's tomorrow night, 6:30 in the youth room. And finally, at the end of every January, we do a town hall meeting as a church where we go over our budget. We talk about where we've been, where we are, and where we're going. But because of the coronavirus, we can't all meet together. So I'm going to videotape that town hall meeting. And here's what you can do for me. You can email me your questions. My email is jstone, J-S-T-O-N-E, at cfcpca.org. And you're thinking, Pastor, you're too busy. I don't want my simple question to bother you. A, because everybody thinks that I'm actually not too busy. Chad is the one who's too busy. They all call Chad because they assume that I'm too busy. So he gets like five times more. This is true, five times more calls than I get. So if you say, hey, how do we do the budget, or what is the future of the youth, or can we remove this cactus I keep stepping on? If you'll email me, any question is legitimate. I'll address it in that video. And then actually after we shoot the video, we will then let you email us more questions. I want to be as above board and out front. We don't have nothing to hide here. Our finances are out there for everybody to see. Those always create a lot of questions. We want to answer those well, or anything else you want to know. So you just email us, and we'll cover that in our town hall meeting. Well, today we are going to look at Psalm 95, as I said earlier in the service. And this is, we're going to spend these first two weeks, this week and next week, talking about worship. The sermons are going to be on worship. In part, I'm motivated by that because often as you preach through Scripture, you can hit different topics about worship. But I get a lot of questions about worship as the pastor, and I enjoy those questions. But one thing you recognize as a pastor, one thing you recognize as a Christian, is the word worship is something that everybody knows, but really few people understand. And so I really want us to think about what the Scriptures say about worship this week and next week, as we understand who we are as the people of God and as we understand who we are as the body of Christ. So Psalm 95, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us become before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Today, if only you would hear his voice. Do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did at Massah, in the wilderness where your ancestors tested me. They tried me, though they had seen what I did. For 40 years I was angry with that generation. I said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. Amen. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God stands forever. Let's pray and ask God to teach us his word. Father, teach us now what Psalm 95 is here to teach us, which in some cases is about worship. There's so many things here. But I pray as we think about worship, we would grow. We would understand more what you would have for us as we come to church, as we read our scriptures, as we sing to you. Help us to give our whole selves to you. And we pray this, Jesus, for your name's sake. Amen. I was talking to a pastor recently, and he made a comment about how much he was enjoying his worship, that their worship at their church was getting super rich and full. And I'll just be honest with you, so I expected him to tell me about their great choir, music team, their new worship leader. And so I said, well, tell me about that. And I just fully expected to hear about music. And instead, he went into a rather lengthy and even, in my opinion, boring discussion about liturgy. And there was nothing wrong with it. I mean, and what he was saying was real, but I thought, oh, wow, like, he's using worship in a really interesting way. He's using it in a way our culture doesn't use it. Because normally, as you walk around and people say, and I get this a lot, it doesn't hurt my feelings, I love your worship, I don't like your worship, I love this, I don't like that. But normally, when people use the word worship, they mean music. And in some sort of modern way, this idea of what worship it has been reduced down to a question of musical interpretation and style. And I'm here to tell you, I'm going to really disappoint you in these 2 weeks. We're not going to touch on that. It is very legitimate to sing old hymns. It is very legitimate to sing new hymns. It's okay to go complete rock and roll. It's okay to go full orchestra, big choir. That's easy. Is it Christ-centered? Do you like it? Go for it. But the word worship in Scripture means something more than music. And it's important that we see the fullness of this word when we use it and we understand it. And I just want to tell you, you already understand worship. You just need to see it. For instance, if you've ever been or you've ever watched a University of Arizona basketball game, you've seen worship. Come, let us sing for joy. There is a song that is sung at the beginning of the games as the cast of characters is played on the display. let us shout aloud to the Arizona Wildcats. We come with thanksgiving when there's a five-star recruit, and we extol him with music and praise. For they are the great team. We hope the team above all teams in the Pac-12, right? I mean, you get my point. What you see there is worship. You also see it around things like children. You see it around things like money. And you see it around things like power. And so in light of the confusion of this, in light of our sort of inherent knowledge of it, I want us to simply see what Psalm 95 teaches us about worship, how we can expand our definition of this word worship and grow in it. And what I want us to see today is, please move, there we go, I thought it was locked up, what worship is, why we worship, and what it does for us. What worship is, why we worship, and what it does for us. The first thing the psalmist teaches us, I think, here is what worship is, and we see that. I sort of made fun of it, but he says, come, let us sing, let us shout, let's come before him, let's extol him, let's bow down in verse 6, let's kneel. He is our God, we are the sheep of his pasture. And what he's teaching us here is that worship is an entire body or life experience. I don't know the right word to hear you, because I don't just mean body, but here's what I mean particularly. True worship engages the mind, the heart, and the body. True worship must engage our mind, our heart, and by that I also mean emotions, and our body. Now, we don't like to say this a lot, especially sort of in certain Protestant circles, but I want you to notice, we're going to come back on this hard next week, that he says, for instance, we bow down, we kneel. Like he's getting into the whole body here. But what I want you to see is real worship is where you give your entire self over to this person. You give your entire being over to this person. I actually appreciated the way we worshiped in this service, and I appreciate both services, because we were clapping. We were becoming emotive. We were singing lyrics that were biblical. We're trying to give our whole selves over to God. You give yourself over to something in a way that engages every aspect of your being. So notice here, for instance, that he says that we should be emotional. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. You see, there is an emotive element that must be present in worship. And maybe I am emphasizing this because I come out of a tradition, it doesn't matter what, that didn't love this. We tended to think a lot about worship. We didn't tend to feel a lot about worship. But worship must get into our very heart, into our emotions, but it also must get into our will, right? It must call us, and he says here over and over in verse 1, come, verse 6, come, and then verse 7 at the end, hear. He's telling you that there's a part of worship, that when it gets in your heart, it begins to change you. It begins to get in your will. But he also says it's important that your worship be content-centered. Because he says in verses 8, 9, 10, and 11, you must understand the story of the Israelites if you're going to have proper worship. You need for that content, that truth, to get in your head. Because here's how it happens. It gets in your head, it goes to your heart, and it comes out in your actions. This is the way worship is. It has to have all three of these. It involves everything. So in the first service, we've had a really hard time with this, and we actually had a hard time with it this morning, which is great. I actually appreciate that. The reason we emphasize standing, kneeling, sitting, hands down, heads up, the reason I would like you to lift your hands like this at the end is I want you to receive the benediction from God, right? Your bodies matter. What we do, like the ancients kneeled. Like, it's only a recent thing. I don't care if we have kneelers. If one of you really wants to give a donation for kneelers, that'd be an interesting proposition. But when you don't use your body, you're not worshiping. When you don't use your mind, you're not worshiping. When it doesn't get into your heart, you don't worship because it involves everything. If it does not connect to your heart, if it does not connect to your will, if it does not connect to your mind, it's not biblical worship. Worship that transforms us is not simply about you and your preferences and what you want. It's about meeting the living God. Now, there's a lot of implications. I'm not going to go far, but And look, our church is guilty of this because every church is. So hear me. This isn't a ch-ch-ch at other people. This is a ch-ch-ch at us. So that means that the church that's sort of always depressed and does like the 47-minute confession of sin is sort of committing the same sin of the church that sings like 27 minutes of praise songs. Neither of those in and of themselves are wrong or even sinful. But worship should involve everything, and I'm the leader, so I'm really shooting at me. We should come in sometimes and sit in quiet. We should come other times and just mourn. And many times we should come and shout, and we're not good at shouting here. We're barely good at clapping, but we were so much better this morning. there was a hint of rhythm there. Like it had all the earmarks of worship right there, right? But see, worship isn't simple. It's not like I felt good, I loved it. It's far deeper than that. I mean, we'll get to it in the last point. This worship ends with a dark warning about hearing him. And so I just want us to see that worship should consume our whole lives. It's not really about us. It's really about him. And transformative worship hits your mind, your heart, and your body. Think about Psalm 73. You may not have read this before, but it's an interesting story about a gentleman, a writer of the Psalms, who has big doubts. He's really frustrated with God. He's not sure following God is worth it. So listen to this. Verse 1 of Psalm 73. Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, he says, my foot had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold in Christ or in God. For I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. They have no struggles. Their bodies are healthy and strong. They are free from common human burdens. They're not plagued by human ills. Therefore, pride is their necklace. They clothe themselves with violence. From their callous hearts comes iniquity. Their evil imaginations have no limits. They scoff and speak with malice. With arrogance, they have threatened oppression. Their mouths lay claim to heaven, and their tongues take possession of the earth. Therefore, their people turn to them and drink up waters in abundance. That's a 15 sermon, two verses right there. They say, I own heaven. They say, I own the world. They say, I am a leader. They say, I am in charge. They say, I have it. And therefore, people follow them. That's why no poor person ever gets elected president. They lay claim to all this. Therefore, their people turn to them and drink their waters in abundance. And then they say, how would God know? Does the Most High know anything? Where's God? This is what the wicked are like. Always free of care. They go on amassing wealth. And this is what he says, and you've been here. Surely in vain I have kept my heart pure. Surely in vain. It's been a waste of my time to follow God. And I have washed my hands, and I'm innocent. All day long, I have been afflicted. Here these rich people are with no problems. And here I am, a follower of God, and all I see is affliction in my life. And every morning brings new punishments. Now, I want to be honest, really honest with you. If someone came into my, and you're free to come in and talk to me, love to, and sat in my office and said this to me, I would make the mistake, it'd be a sin, and say, and I'm not being callous, I think you need to talk to a counselor. And that's not the way God does it. He says, if I had spoken out like that, I would have betrayed our children. When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply. This is a person in deep doubt, till I entered the sanctuary of God. Worship is transformative. There is nothing like it. As we sit here today as the people of God, there are unique Bible promises that apply nowhere else in the world. He has said things about gathered worship in the Scriptures. We'll look at some of them. That are not said that the individual doesn't get. Of course, you're loved by God. Of course, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit. Right? But there's something powerful about us getting together. He goes on and talks about how this worship changed his mind in verses 18 through 28, and you can look at that in Psalm 73. See, worship is intended to make us understand the worth of God as we see him in Christ Jesus. Worship is giving the worth to something it deserves. And we want our worship to cause us to see the worth that we have and that God has in Jesus, so that we will ascribe it to him, so we will be caught up in that worthiness. And that requires your whole self. It requires you to assign Jesus as the ultimate value, because he's the great God, and his and who he is changes everything. Worship is never just one emotion. It's never just one thing. Lots of things go into great worship. And what we see is the mind is the gateway to the heart, and the heart is the engine of the will, and that's what happens in worship, is that we give ourselves completely to Jesus Christ. Which brings me to my second point. And this point is not exactly for y'all. It's really for people listening, and I know many Christians are listening, but it's also for some of our non-Christian friends who sometimes join us. You'd be surprised how many non-Christians I know here who write me letters and say, I love what you're talking about. I just don't agree with any of it. And this is for you. What this psalm is saying, and what really all of Scripture is saying, is everyone is a worshiper. It's easy for us to say, and I'll quote a friend I've met who says, you know, Christians worship and everybody else doesn't worship. That's not how the Scriptures see us. What it teaches us is that everyone worships because everybody assigns something ultimate value in their life. You were made to. As it was said once, you know, there's a God-sized hole in our hearts for everybody, not just for Christians, but for everybody. And we all have something we ascribe that ultimate worth to. We've already done this. You are a worshiper. You either worship Jesus Christ or you worship something else. It's not that we worship Jesus and you don't worship. You're worshiping. See, the average Tucson person, and I want to describe this person in detail because he's all over Bisbee Breakfast Club. So here's what Tucson is full of, and I've gotten to know these guys. And it's sort of funny, but it's tragic. They are 50 to 70-year-old men who've left their first family, who have more money than they know what to do with, who've moved to Tucson to do a couple of things. One is to wear flip-flops and Hawaiian shirts. And the two is be left alone. And they're all over this town. And if you can get one to engage you in a conversation and they find out you're a preacher, they immediately want to get out of that conversation. But they always say something about my religiosity. And they often say this: I'm not a religious person. I don't believe in God. I so appreciate that you do that. You need that. But I don't need that. I don't worship. And you're going to have some of your friends tell you this as you engage them in the mission of God. Here's what I would encourage you to learn to say prayerfully, carefully, and hear me, with humility. Because this is what I said. I said, I understand what you mean, but I need you to know something. You and I are both worshipers. We just have different objects. See, you're worshiping, I said this to one, you're worshiping your aloneness. I'm trying to worship Jesus. Everyone's worshiping. You have a deepest, desperate desire because you were born with it. And you have an object of your affection. And whatever that object is, it controls you. It could be money, it could be power, it could be love, it could be affection, and Instagram is making it true every day. It could be attention. But you have locked your heart deeply into something, and it is controlling you. And I didn't make this up, Jesus did. Jesus says this: do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth. Now, just for a moment, in the context of the Foothills and Catalina Foothills Church, just set aside the idea of wealth and money just for this moment. And hear Jesus saying something deeper about idolatry. It's not just about money, what he's saying. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Everyone has a treasure. And that treasure creates worship. See, Jesus is saying, for where your treasure is, there your heart will also. But notice something. He says, the eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, meaning if you're taking in good stuff, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, longing after wealth or power or love, your body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? He's actually saying, because we're sinners and we take in sin, it gets worse. But then he says this, no one can serve two masters. Now, we all know this if we grew up in the church. If you didn't, you don't know it. But we all talk about this. You got to have one or the other. But he's actually saying something. You're serving a master. If you've been born, you are serving a master. And that is worship. You are giving everything to that master. And he says this. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. You cannot serve both God and the thing you're choosing. So I want to say this not only to my non-Christian friends who are so kind to be with us, but to Christians. Where is your heart? Where is your treasure? The scripture would like you to identify that. See, if life is protecting, let's use Jesus' words, wealth, here's what will happen to you. You will become deeply rich and deeply unsatisfied at the same moment. When people put their trust in wealth, the more they have, the less happy they are, always. And they become less generous. That's why one of the crazy stats the IRS puts out is that people who make under $60,000 a year give away by percentage far bigger chunks than people over $60,000 a year. Isn't that fascinating? The more you have, the more you hold. Why? Because you're worshiping it. But that ain't my problem. I ain't got enough money to worship that, right? So some of us got some other problems. That's a preacher joke. Yeah, Jesus takes care of me. It's fine. But if you worship kids and family, that Christians love to go, I'm a Christian, therefore I'm all into family. If kids and family are what you're here to worship, then you will find yourself one day in a room full of your children, your grandchildren, your husband, and their friends, and you will feel this, alone, lost, and abandoned. Because family is not a substitute for ultimately worshiping Jesus. If power is what you seek, you will become powerless through the power you seek, and it'll never be enough. The interesting one, I told in the first service, when I turned 55, my Instagram and all the advertisements showing up on my computer were about long life. Here's what you do to live to be 120. I'm like, no one wants to live to be 120. Good grief. But you understand, as people get older, they realize they're going to die and they become obsessed with long life. And that means if you become obsessed with long life, that you don't get to enjoy 55 because you're doing all this stuff to make sure you make it to 120. You are a worshiper, Christian or non-Christian. A human being is a worshiper. Tell me, where is your treasure? This was a little bit of the discussion this week, wasn't it? This was the discussion on Wednesday, apart from the fact that a bunch of prayer Bible studies broke out into a revolution, sort of. Who are we and who do we belong to and who has power? Well, it's an easy answer for me. I'm going to kneel before the Lord, my maker. He is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He owns those mountains. They are his. He owns this church. You see, worship was happening on Wednesday, just not of the true and living God. Because worship of the true and living God always leads us to grace and mercy and love and forgiveness, right? Which brings me to my final point. Worship actually does something to us here. And it's sort of obvious that it helps us grow in Christ and helps us grow as Christians. But I want you to notice, in some ways, the darkness of the way this passage ends, because he says, in verse 7, sort of the end of 7, he says, today, if only you would hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massah in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested me, they tried me, though they had seen what I had done. And you don't see this very much. For 40 years, I was angry with that generation. I said, there are people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my way. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. What Jesus, what the scriptures are teaching us, is that worship creates a big dividing point for people. And it either brings you life or it brings you death. As you come to worship, you're being forced to decide who you are and who God is. And I'm actually going to make some justification for it this week. But one of the reasons I want you to confess your sins, and some of you will say, and keep saying it, it's okay that you're saying it, John, that's rote. We should do that every week. And I'm saying, we're not always doing it for you. We're doing it for people who are looking at us. Because we want them to hear us say this, that if you put us in charge of the world, we already know we would fail. Because we're coming here as sinners. See, worship forces me to say, I have not kept your law. I have utterly betrayed it in every way. And that's not a cool thing to say. That's not a place where you want to stand in ultimate joy before God. In fact, you sort of want to bow down. Because worship divides us. Because it says, who are you and who God is? It's not neutral and it can kill you. I mean, in the New Testament, these young, innocent Christians bring an offering to the apostles, and they lied about it. And the husband brought it, and the apostle said, hey, you didn't have to give us a dime, but you decided to give us this and claim it was the total value of what you sold, but you're lying, so you're dead. He died. They picked him up. They carried him out of the church. That's a worship service, everybody remembered. His wife walked in. He went out the back door. She came in the front door, and the apostle said, is this the full amount of the sale of the field? And she said, yes, and she died. Paul says that the Christians are not discerning the body of Christ. It's not really about non-Christians. When they take communion, they're showing favoritism. They're saying the rich and the important are more important than the poor, and they were actually doing it in their worship service. So if that had been here, let's imagine there were much poorer people and much richer people. What they were saying is, you get the communion first, you get the best seats, it will get to you. And this is what Paul says, and that's why some of you have died. He takes worship way more seriously than we do. And that's what he's saying. See, worship can kill you, but here's the more important. It can also give you rest. And I can tell you what we would like today in light of the coronavirus and the politics of our country. We would like rest. We would like to not wake up more tired tomorrow with 9 hours of sleep than we were today. And another day of breathing through a mask and going, what? I can't understand you. What? What did you say? You're at the drive-thru. I just want a cheeseburger. See, the offer here is the greatest offer that God could give someone. Come into my rest. I mean, this is a whole sermon. What is his rest? He owns the mountains. He made the sea. He owns the universe. No one can touch him. No one can defy him. His whole will is accomplished. He's inviting you to have that. In the gospel, he's inviting you to rest. And I want you to notice that this rest means that we worship him with all of our being, and therefore we trust him. See, we trust him for what he did in the past. He sent his only son who died for us so that we know we're loved. We trust him in the present because we know he's filled us with his spirit. And we know this even when we don't see it. We know that he is our God and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. This morning and on Wednesday morning, you were under his care. And you cannot be removed from that. In the present, he's loving us. But I think even more powerfully in the future, right now, Jesus is building you a home in heaven. That's a real thing. He's building a place for you, that when you see it, you will only remember the foothills as the worst ghetto you were ever in. The most impoverished, ugly place you can remember will be this, because you will see what he's prepared for you. See, this rest is a rest in His love. It's a rest in His arms. It's exactly why we want to put communion in front of you every week, because I can't do what that can do, because there Jesus stands saying, I gave up my body for you. I gave up my blood for you. I gave up my life for you. It's all I had. It's yours. Come and love me. Enter into my rest. We've all had this experience. This is a really hard thing to illustrate, actually, but we've done it. I can remember one day being at a playground with a bunch of children who were just having a blast, and it was a great day and a great picnic, and the children were over there and the parents were over here, and then you heard the blood-curdling scream. Now, what that means is a four-year-old fell 2 feet off of something because his brother pushed him. So you have to interpret the blood-curdling scream as how much he was hurt and how much he's trying to get his brother in trouble, right? There's some of that going on. But every once in a while, like, they really get hurt, right? They're on the monkey bars, and their brother has put them up at a level they should not be at, right? Like, oh, let's put baby up here and have him hold on to him, pow. And here's what happens every time. When that baby jumps up, when that child jumps up, maybe really hurt, they look around, and they always do the same thing. They look right past dad. Dad's coming, and they don't really care about dad, because dad is fun, but he's not help, right? In fact, I have seen a kid, I heard the wife say, would you go get him? Like, she's done with it, right? Dad goes, kid runs straight at him, does the juke around him, and runs and jumps on mom, because mom's love. Mom is Band-Aids. Mom is care. And you've seen this, too, especially if you've worked for our kids in our nursery. And if you're here, we need more volunteers. We need folks to bring their kids here and be cared for, and you can do it. Especially those of you in the forward, no mass section. You shouldn't have sat in that no mass section, should you? You can go volunteer in the nursery. We need you. But you've seen this in the nursery. You know, it's at the end of a long shift, and one of the kids just decides, he's had enough, or she's had enough, and they fall apart. They're hungry. They're missing their nap. They're missing their mom, and they just get inconsolable. And so there's always one nursery worker that can console every child, and then they get this child, and nope. It ratchets up until mom steps up. And I've seen this happen. You literally hand crazed child to mom. Child falls asleep instantly. Because that's the place of rest. This place, when we gather with the unique promises of God, as God's people, not because John Stone told you, not because our session should, because we're the people of God gathering in the name of Jesus, there's rest for our souls. This is the place you can come and know that your mother and father love you. And you can fall asleep in their arms in a world of chaos, in a world of illness, in a world of death. We invite you into worship to enter into His rest. Would you pray with me? Father, we pray that as we come to your table, we would come as worshipers, giving our whole life, our whole body, our whole mind to you. And Lord, I pray that you would identify for us those objects of worship which steal your worship that you deserve from us as we worship and distort you with power and children and wealth and attention and affection. But we ask mostly that you would bring us into your rest, that it wouldn't be true about us that you were angry with us for a whole generation, but that we heard you, we heard your word, and we heard about Jesus Christ, and we gave ourselves to him. And we pray this, Jesus, for your name's sake. Amen. We come to the table of the Lord, as we always do, and we come to eat and drink of the blood of Christ set before us here. What we have represented here in the bread and the wine is the body of Christ, and the bread and in the wine or the juice is represented the blood of Christ. And what we're saying here simply is that we believe that Jesus is the Christ, the fulfillment of the Old Testament. He is not only the Son of God, He is God. He is the great I Am, and He, in a mysterious way, died in your place. Where you should have died and been punished for your sins, He died and was punished for your sins. But it's something more remarkable than that. The righteous acts that Jesus did, the feeding of the 5,000, the raising of Lazarus, that's credited to your account. So that now you are not only forgiven, but you are righteous before God. The righteousness of Jesus is on you. And we celebrate that in the eating of this bread and wine by faith. And if you're not a Christian today, we would encourage you not to eat of this. We have no desire to exclude you or embarrass you or do anything like that. We're simply telling you that this is a confession of faith. We're giving all of our lives, all of our money, our time, our children, ourselves to Jesus. And in eating of this, we're confessing that. If you're not ready to confess that, I wouldn't eat of it. But if indeed you are a Christian today, we'd invite you to come, because on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. He broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Eat this as often as you do so in remembrance of me." And he also took a cup and said, "This cup represents a new covenant made in my blood for the forgiveness of sins of many. Drink it as often as you do so in remembrance of me, and therefore proclaim my death until I come." Let's take a moment of silence to prepare for this eating of this meal. Amen. Christians, we break bread in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we declare the great mystery of faith. Jesus Christ has died. Jesus Christ is risen. Jesus Christ will come again. These are the gifts of God, and they are for the people of God. The body of Christ broken for you. Eat with great joy. This is the blood of Christ. It was poured out for you. Drink with great joy. Since we talked about it, let's stand. You put your palms down to receive. I'm going to put my palms up to give the blessing of God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you both today and forevermore. Amen.
All right, let's sing one more time before we leave this morning. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. One more time. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Amen.
How you doing?